Good morning. Happy Rodeo Sunday at New Hope Church. It's great to have you with us today. I love that up there. How many of you been to the rodeo already? Raise your hand. You've been already. Good, 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 good. Clovisites. How many's going today for the finals? Okay, good. I'll see all four of you there. All right. It will be a packed house, though. But we're glad you're here this morning. Welcome to New Hope. If it's your first time here, it's an honor and a privilege to have you as a guest. And there are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take one and fill it out, drop it in the offering when it comes by. We promise not to harass you or annoy you, but just through the mail, we're going to send you some information that tells you what goes on around here, what we believe, the kind of ministries that take place, and hopefully that will answer most of your questions. Jenna, where'd you go, girl? Did she? Oh, right here. All right, you came. Hey, stand up. Stand up real quick. You guys recognize this girl? Yeah, it's good to have Jenna back with us. She's part of our high school college group, and then she got married and moved away, and her husband's being deployed now overseas, and so she's back home with us, and we're excited about that. So good to see you. My wife thrilled me with that news. I think it was Friday. And she saw you on a text, and wow, and here you are. It's good. It's good. Let me highlight a few announcements and then some prayer requests, and then we'll get engaged in the rest of our worship today. This afternoon, right after the last service, 12:15 over in the surf area, if you are a parent of a surf kid, fourth, fifth, or sixth grade, there's a meeting for parents or grandparents about your kid going to camp this year. Camp dates are July 31st through August the 5th, and if you have any questions about that, you'll want to be at that meeting today, all right? So they would love to have you there. It will not take very long. I've got one sign-up sheet that's going to come around, and it's for an event that is this Friday. We did it last year. It's a simulcast. This is a six-hour Bible study, 3:30 to 9:30, nonstop. There will be refreshments available to keep you refreshed throughout that 6 hours. In fact, if I remember, last year when we did it something like 5:30 to 11:30, I think. We were here late, all right? It's intense. It is good. You'll see the subject. It's in there. He's dealing with a relationship with Christ in the environment of world religion. And it's just good stuff. They provide you with a binder. There's some fill-in-the-blank as you go along. But it's great material to have afterwards to review. And so if you're going to be attending that, there's a cost of just $10 for the simulcast and the materials. And it's a good bit of material that you get. And we want to make sure we have enough for those who are attending. Usually, I mean, last year I think we had about 14 or 15 who attended. All of us enjoyed it thoroughly. It's going to be over in the office building in the meeting room on the far side. If we have more sign-ups than could fit in there, we have another room, but we need to be where there's a good TV for the simulcast to be displayed upon. So we'd love to know of your presence of that, and I think you would thoroughly enjoy it and be challenged by it. Mexico Mission Night next Sunday evening right here at New Hope. Chris is really excited about this special event. If you're new to New Hope, during Easter week, we had 66 or 67 junior high school, college, and adults go down to Mexico, involved in a building project at an orphanage there. It was a church-wide engaged activity from the pie auction that raised a lot of chunk of the funds for that to take place, for individual contributions to help some of our kids get there. And they want to share back with you what happened that week. So from 5:30 to 7 o'clock here at the church next Sunday night, our youth group will be in charge, and they're going to be showing you pictures, and they're going to be sharing testimonies with you, and you'll get an idea of all that transpired and what that investment of time and resources was all about. And to kind of set the environment for you, from 5:30 to 6, there's going to be a taco truck in the parking lot, so you can come and eat, buy your taco, a taco truck, and I hear rumor churros are going to be available. Okay? So, not only will you come out and find some good information, but you can enjoy some good eats as well. So that's next Sunday night, 5:30 to 7. So those are just the announcements of events that we wanted to bring up to date to you. This afternoon at 1:30, right here in the sanctuary, is going to be the renewal of vows for Earl and Emma Rowland. They have celebrated 60 years of marriage together, And Emma has persuaded Earl to enlist for 60 more. And so today there's going to be a brief renewal of vow ceremony with them, followed by a reception over in the bridge area. And it is open for you to attend. They ask if I could announce that. And so we would love to have you share and participate in that. And if you see Earl and Emma between the services, give them a big hug and congratulate them. A few prayer requests. Mike and Debbie Kalugian, they're known by many around here. They're not regulars here because they are part of a church down in Coway. We have assisted that church with some special events over the last, 6 or 7 years. And Debbie, Mike's wife, has been diagnosed about 7 years ago with MS. And hers has been rapidly escalating. And along with that, a little over 12 months ago, she was diagnosed with cancer and had to go through radiation treatment. And that combination of things has not been well for her health. So last Tuesday evening, Mike sponsored, just by word of mouth, a MS fundraising dinner at the fairgrounds. He happens to be a member of the fair board, and the fair has built a really cool new building. Whenever you get an opportunity to go see it, and I don't know how it's going to work, but they've put in a Fresno County Historical Museum. Remember how you used to enter from Chance? And when you would go in on the right between the walkway and the Pow Pow Theater, it was all the food booths. Those aren't going to be there anymore, probably. They're going to get moved elsewhere because there's now a 2-story building there. And it is awesome inside, man. Clovis even has a rodeo wall, all right? They don't have an Al Gould saddle yet, but I think we're going to work on that one. But pretty impressive facility inside, and so Mike was able to kind of launch the very first public event there for this dinner and trying to raise funds for MS. And Debbie was there, and she spoke. She had to speak from a sitting position because her legs are not real strong. And I just want you to, I told Mike we'd be praying for him. They've been very kind to us here at New Hope over the years, and we want to extend that kindness back in our prayers for them. Joni Jarbo, stand up and wave, girl, because you're back with us. All right, welcome back. Good to have you. That was a brief stand, wasn't it? Yeah. Joni, as you know, she was up in Oregon for the last couple of weeks taking care of her grandchild. Her daughter, who gave birth to her grandchild last year, was diagnosed during that pregnancy with cancer, but had to postpone treatment till after the birth of her baby. And now treatment has started. She could not be around her baby during the treatment. And so Joni was up there. And treatment is now finished. She's back with us. And they'll have results sometime next week. So continue to be in prayer for them and their family. Bernice Osborne, who's normally sitting right back there between Mike and my dad, is not back there today. Yeah, now that's Mike's wife sitting back there today. Yes, yes. But Bernice, who's often sitting back there, is not able to be with us today. She had a fall, and she has a fractured bone. And so please remember to pray for her and her recovery. We have a young man sitting between the Browns right up here. Alec, how are you, son? All right, give me five. Give me five. Alec made a trip from, was it North or South Dakota? North Dakota. Met his grandparents in Idaho Falls this week and is back here. He's going to be having some tests and appointments at Valley Children's Hospital. They have found some things that they need to investigate, and he could not get into a specialist in North Dakota till August. And so Children's Hospital can do it a little bit faster. And so wonderful grandparents make that possible. And so we're gonna pray for Alec today. All right, Alec? You don't seem to be very bashful to me. So would you mind come standing with me right here in the center aisle? Because I want to pray at this moment just for you, okay? How old are you, Alec?
11.
11. What grade are you in?
Fifth
grade. Wow, you're taller than I was in the fifth grade, let me tell you. So we're just going to pray for you right now, okay? And ask for God's very, very best in your life. We love your grandparents, so that means we kind of like you. All right? All right. Let's pray. Our Father, I love you. I thank you so much for Alec. Thank you for the gift that he has been to his family. And thank you for what you have been doing in his life for these past 11 years. We know right now he's got some health challenges. And I pray for courage in his life. I pray for strength. I pray for I pray for a real sense of peace in the life of his family as they await results. Father, we seek and pray that the right doctors at the right time will be in the right place, and they will use the best skills that they have learned, the gift that you have given to them. And Father, we are simply praying for your best in the outcomes of this situation. So we trust you for it. I'm grateful Alec could be with us today. And I look forward to our opportunity of getting better acquainted with Alec in the weeks ahead. We trust you for his needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, buddy. Thank you. Okay, you bet. Jad Patton, we've gotten some good reports over the last few days that there have been some good steps of improvement, and so we are grateful for that. Still a process of recovery yet for her, but continue to remember her. Lots of families have been challenged with sorrow and grief, and we have them listed here. Would you please remember all those services we've had this past week? Coming up this next Friday is Billy Adams, my Aunt Toot. Her memorial service will be here at New Hope on Friday at 2:30. You are certainly welcome. If you knew Billy, we'd love to have you here. We also have another young lady from our congregation. She's in our youth group. Her name is Jordan. I think I saw Jordan's aunt come in, didn't I? Yeah, I didn't know. Aren't you back there? Wait. Oh, she had to go out. Okay, all right. And Jordan was at Valley Children's Hospital this week, though she's a teen, still at Valley Children's. And they were doing a biopsy on a mass that's been pressing against her rib, 10th or 11th rib. And this would be a pretty quick in and out biopsy, but it took much, much longer because once in there, they discovered the bone on that rib is not what it should be. And they don't. It's one of those things, as of yet, you don't know, has the rib caused the mass? Has the mass caused the problem with the rib? Or are they not even related to each other? Those are all the various options. And so it took them a little longer because they wanted to biopsy the rib as well. If you know Jordan, she is a pistol. She is a ball of fire. She is a cheerleader. She is active in athletics. Even after this lengthy biopsy procedure, when we walked into her recovery room, she was asking her mother if on the way from the hospital she could drop her off at Clovis Baseball Field so she could be there for the baseball game Friday evening. So pretty tenacious, but no answers. We will not have any answers until mid to the latter part of next week. It is painful. And so we would appreciate you remembering to pray for Jordan. She will be here, we hope. She believes she's going to be here for our last service. And we will have a special time of prayer with Jordan at that time. But she would appreciate her and her family, all of our prayers in the process of this. Also in the next service, we have a baby dedication for the Shasky family. So just so you know, that's a special event in our next service as well. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. Oh, Arlene Brobst is in the hospital this morning. I just found that out at the very beginning of the 8 o'clock service. I did talk to Jim during the service, and she's not in her room yet. She is at St. Agnes Hospital. She's in the emergency. They believe this is just, she's got a lot of nausea and weakness from the treatment that she is going through for her cancer. So we don't know anything more than that at this particular moment. Would appreciate you remembering Arlene today in your prayers. Let's pray. Father, there are some weeks that it just seems like complications of health concerns, family members who have stepped from time into eternity. It just sometimes seems like life can be very, very wearisome. And yet, Father, if we're not careful, we allow the frustrating things of life to prompt us to miss things like a baby dedication, to miss things like a birthday celebration, to miss things like a 60th anniversary renewal of vows. We can get so caught up and drugged down in the things in this world that cause us trouble, that we miss the things in this world that you use to bring us joy. And Father, the thing that you do most of all is you come to live within us, and you're very straightforward in telling us that in this world. Until you come again, there will be trouble. But that you will not abandon us during our time of trouble. You will give us comfort for our sorrow. You will give us hope for our discouragement. You will give us strength for our weakness. And so, Father, for the abundance of, for an abundance of your resources, for the lack of our abilities, we trust you today. We commit you to you the needs of Jordan and Alec and Arlene and others in our fellowship who are facing health challenges and tests. And for Bernice, as she's recuperating and recovering. We trust you for all these and more. Lord, for those who are in this service and they have needs, that the kind of needs that we can't see and the kind of needs that maybe we don't like to talk about, but the kind of needs that you are prepared to care for and minister to, we surrender those to you as well. For the privilege of giving and sharing today, dear Father, we say thanks. For your word as it's opened, may we allow your word to speak to each of us that it might fulfill what the scripture says is the responsibility of your word, and that is to be a light to our feet and a lamp to our path. And Father, when your word is a light and lamp to our path, it reminds us that we don't face anything in life alone. But we face it with you. And that makes all the difference in the world. We trust you with all this in the incredible name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. That last song is a song I think challenges us at the very core of who we are. It's one of the challenges about music is we like to listen to it. We like to sing it. Quite frequently, I think we sing. We even participate in worship. And yet the message which the writer intended kind of skips right by us. I'm afraid we can even do the same thing with Scripture. We have our daily devotion. We participate in our Bible study. We sit in the sanctuary on a Sunday morning and we do the routine and we read the scripture. And if we're not really careful, it skips right by us. And that last song, it's not a complicated message. Some songs you got to listen from beginning to end to really get the thrust of what's said. But this one, this particular song gets at the core of what the desire of God's heart is for us as we share this life that we call a life of faith. It's not a life of a Baptist or a Presbyterian. It's not a life of a New Hopian. It's the life of God in us. And the challenge to the song is, Jesus, you're the center. Not the peripheral. Not when I have time. Not when the occasion is good. But this is really about every moment of every day, of every circumstance, of every decision, of every issue of life. Jesus, you're at the center. We get so caught up with so many things. I as I'm sitting there listening to that and singing it, I'm thinking, man, I think this is what David had in mind when he wrote Psalm 37. When we pull all the little pieces out of Psalm 37 and we try to nail it down, it's, as I shared with you last week, for those of you who weren't here last week, let me see if I can recap quickly. I didn't finish last Sunday's sermon, so I'm going to finish it today. We're in a study on the Psalms. And the reason we're in the Psalms, we're going to be there all year. All year, 52 weeks, we're going to be in one book of the Bible. And we'll be looking at a variety of chapters. We can't get through the whole Psalms because there's, 150 of them. And so we don't have that many Sundays. But we're gonna look at about 45 of them throughout this year. And we're doing that because we're wanting to learn more about how to live this less more lifestyle. less frustration, more faith. Less impatience, more patience. Less frustration, more joy. Less anger, more peace. And we do that by making a choice, by being consistent with that choice, by accountability, and then by contemplation, thinking on the truths and the principles and the precepts of God's Word. That's what enables this less more lifestyle to be functional in us. And this particular psalm that we jumped into last week is different than all the others we've looked at before. And so far where I've worked ahead, it's very different than all the ones we're going to be in the next several weeks. What makes it different is the style in which David wrote it, though David wrote the vast majority of the songs in this Old Testament hymn book that we call the Psalms. That the structure of this one is so different that you could pluck Psalm 37 out and you could add a chapter to Proverbs and it would fit perfectly because it's written like a proverb rather than a song. And last week what we did is we looked at only the first nine verses of the 37th Psalm. And from that we looked at a warning that David gave. We looked at five precepts that David shared. And then we looked at the blessing that comes out of heeding the warning and following the precepts. And I think I shared with you last week how I pictured this. And I have no evidence if what I'm about to say is true or not. It just seems reasonable. It seems reasonable that David wrote this late in his life. And in fact, there's a verse that we'll get to today that I think verifies that fact, that David wrote this particular one late in his life. And so what I picture is David sitting down with Solomon, his son that he knows is going to follow in his footsteps to the throne of Israel. He's going to be the next king when David dies. And I see David sitting down as a father with a son and saying, "Son, my days are numbered. And there are some things I want to make sure you know are important. There are some things I want to make sure I didn't forget to tell you. And there are some things I want to make sure you never forget." And so I see a dad sitting down with a son, having that kind of conversation. Last week, as we looked at those first nine verses, let me just highlight this. The warning, it's right there, and it's the first three words of verse 1 of Psalm 37. Do not fret! It's the old version of the Canadian saying, don't worry, be happy. Okay? David is saying, hey, son, I don't want you to fret. I don't want you to worry. And then he gives them one of the things I don't want you to worry about. I don't want you to worry because of evil. Pause to think about that for a moment. How many of our worries are a result of evil? Just about every one of them that I can think of is traced to some kind of evil, all right? We can talk about sickness. That's traced to some kind of evil, all right? Without sin in the world, there wouldn't be sickness in the world. So it has its roots there. Fractured relationships. There's often some kind of evil that's engaged in that. It's sometimes we might not want to classify things like stubborn, like angry, like revengeful. We might not want to call those things evil, but that's what they are. Very, very few things are neutral. And so David is reminding Solomon, you're gonna be in charge, and being in charge of Israel, you're gonna see a lot of evil. And man, it's gonna consume you if you worry about it. And so he says, don't fret over evil and evil men. Why? Because they die. Don't worry about evil men, because one day they'll be gone. And I think we can add to that, don't worry about evil, because one day, that's our hope, guys. That's part of the hope that we possess. Oh, let me pause here. We got to define that this is a chapter about wickedness and righteousness, about evil and goodness. Those who are righteous that David's talking about here, they were once wicked. They were once wicked. We got to somehow get this clear in our head, guys, and we don't like to do this. Every single one of us born since Cain and Abel, we were born into wickedness. Every one of us. That doesn't fly well in 20 and 21st century living. And the reason it doesn't fly well is because we like to think, I'm okay, you're okay. No, the reality is, I'm wicked, you're wicked. That's not okay. But it's true. And the reason we don't like to talk about that is because what we like to do is we like to find somebody we know is more wicked than us, and we can say, I'm not as wicked as them. And since I'm not as wicked as them, I must be a bit righteous. But God's very specific. God says it this way, all. If I were to say, y'all who are here today, everybody who's in the room today, I'm going to give, let's just go big, I'm going to give $1 million. So you know this isn't true, okay? If I'd have said $10, you might think that was true, and then I would, you know, be forced to pay it. But you know this is crazy. But I might say, hey, y'all, everybody in the room, all of you who are here today, you're going to get $1 million. Which one of you would think that doesn't apply to you? Yeah, you all would think, well, he said all. I had a professor in Bible college who said all means all, and that's all that all means. And he, you know, pretty well sums it up. No, if I said all of you who are here are going to get $1 million, there's not a one of you who would want to be left out. God says all of us in this room are sinners. Doesn't leave any one of us out. He doesn't grade the sinners. You're an A sinner and you're a D sinner. And then he says the result of being a sinner is this. All have sinned and we have fallen short of God's glory. For the wages of sin, the result of us being sinners, the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God, for God so loved the world that he gave. Here's his gift. But the gift of God is eternal life. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life to all who believe. We move from wickedness to righteousness. For today, y'all are the wicked, okay? To righteousness by receiving a gift. We move from one side to the other. And it's not my righteousness. I don't move from my wickedness to my righteousness. I move from my wickedness to his righteousness. Because the Bible says it this way, my righteousness, my good attempts at being good, the attempts of a wicked man or woman, the attempts of wickedness to be good, is filthy rags, fit for the garbage. But God says, I will take your wickedness and I will exchange it. And I will take out what once was your wickedness and I will put into you what is now my righteousness. And that's a wonderful gift that is ours. It's about as simple as it gets, but that's as truthful as it gets. David understood that, so he gave us a warning, do not fret. And then he gives us these five important precepts in the next few verses, and it's laid out for us at verse 3, trust and obey. Here's a way to know if you're trusting. Are you obeying? If you're not obeying, you're not trusting. I'm not asking you to obey me, and I'm not asking you to obey New Hope Church. I'm asking you to obey God's truth. And that'll outline for us more in just a minute. So trust and obey. Number 2, delight and enjoy. And that is found in verse 4. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. You see, if I delight myself in the Lord, then I'm going to discover what his desires are, and his desires for me are going to be a whole lot better than my desires for me. And so it makes it really easy for God to give me the desires of my heart because my desires match his desires. That's pretty cool, isn't it? but it's challenging. Number three, we are to commit and shine. That is in verse 5. Commit our ways to the Lord, and here's what he's going to do. He'll make our righteousness, which he's given to us, so it's really his righteousness, shine like the dawn, and the justice of our cause like the noonday sun. And the fourth thing he challenges us to do is to rest and to wait. Maybe the hardest thing for any of us is to wait, is to wait. Most of us only like one answer. Most of us only like to hear yes to any question, favor that we ask. We only like yes. And sometimes God says no, and you got to learn to like no. And sometimes he says wait, and you got to learn to accept wait. He says, don't hurry into action. Remember, time is not an issue with God. God is never too slow. He is never too fast. I got to do some more research on this, but I don't think God ever runs. I don't think I've ever found a place where it says God ran. All right? I know God doesn't sweat. Okay? Because work's not hard for him. And the fifth precept is refrain and turn. This is an about face. Refrain from what wickedness would push you to do and turn towards righteousness. And this is the result of often resting and waiting. And then the ultimate blessing is for those who wait on the Lord. Verse 9, those who hope in the Lord, they will inherit the land. We get to enjoy. No signal. It's all right. Not a problem. Here we go. Just up the road from a man's house, there was a field. And in this field, there were two horses. From a distance, both of these horses looked like every other horse. But if you were to pull your car off the side of the road and get out, walk up to the fence, check both of the horses very carefully, you would notice something really rather amazing. If you looked into the eyes of one of the horses, it would reveal to you the fact that he's blind. He can't see. His owner has chosen not to have him put down, but he's made a very good home for him. And this alone is very amazing. If nearby and you're listening intently, what you would hear from the field is the tinkling of a bell. And if you look to find the source of the bell, what you would discover is it comes from the second smaller horse in the field. For you see, attached to the halter of the horse is a small bell, and it's that bell that lets her blind friend know where she is so he can follow her. As you stand and watch these two friends in the field, you'll see how she is always checking on him, that he will listen for her bell, and then he'll slowly walk to where she is, trusting that she will lead him to good grass, to good water, and that she will not lead him astray. When she returns to the shelter of the barn every evening, she stops occasionally and she looks back for her friend, making sure that he's not too far behind and he's not too far where he can't hear the bell, so he gets back to the stable for his night's rest. Like the owner of these two horses, God does not throw us away just because we are not perfect. God does not throw us away just because of our wickedness. He watches over, and he often sends and brings others into our lives to help us when we are in need. Sometimes you and I are the blind horse, needing to be guided by the little ringing of the bell of those lives that God places in our life. Other times, God will put a bell on our halter, asking us to be a lead horse for somebody else. Good friends are like this. We don't always see them, but we know they're there. Please, let's have ears that listen for each other's bells. God has sent them. And I think God had put a bell on David's halter as he penned Psalm 37. Let's jump in at verse 10. This is going to be very different than the way in which I normally preach. I have no other notes on this chapter. I have no other note up here with me. We're just going to simply walk and talk our way through the rest of these verses. Okay? So let's jump in. Verse 10. A little while. Now remember, time doesn't matter to God. And my little while and your little while may be very different from each other. Okay? For you, a little while might be 15 minutes. For me, it's about 10 seconds. Okay? For God, it could be a couple of millenniums. 1,000 years is as one day. 1 day is as 1,000 years. But according to God's timing, in a little while, the wicked will be no more. Okay? That's why he said, don't fret. The day's coming when evil will not exist. Though you look for them, it will not be found. But the meek, they will inherit the earth and they will enjoy great peace. Not just peace, but great peace. Why? Because there's no evil to disrupt any of the peace. Verse 12, the wicked, who at the moment are still around because the little while hasn't come to an end yet, the wicked plot against the righteous and they gnash their teeth at them. I don't know if we understand what that is in our. Have you ever had anybody gnash their teeth at you? I got to be honest. I'm not sure I've ever seen that. It sounds disgusting. It sounds annoying. Yeah, somebody. You know, I've seen my dad take his teeth out. Okay, but I've never had anybody gnash. Yeah, now they're going to turn and say, "Would you do it?" That's right, Pop. Later. But man, it seems disgusting and an ugly thing to do. It's kind of like, man, I'd bite you if I could. And that's what the wicked want to do to the righteous. They get so mad. They get so mad at righteousness. But notice the sense of humor God has. This God who I've never discovered runs, he does laugh. The Lord laughs at the wicked, for he knows that their day is coming. Have you ever laughed when somebody said something to you and you knew something they didn't know and what they said or what they did was really, really goofy? In the light of what you knew that they didn't know? and then they wonder, why are you laughing at me? Because there's nothing funny about the situation to them. That's God right here. God says, I know your end. So all this crud you're doing, it's really pretty funny. He appreciates irony. The Lord laughs at the wicked, for he knows their day is coming. And remember this. The righteous were once wicked. God's not laughing at us if we have appropriated his righteousness by receiving his gift. We've moved from one side to the other. The wicked draw the sword, they bend the bow. And why do they do this? Because they want to bring down the poor and needy. They want to slay those whose ways are upright. But their swords, these instruments that they intended for destruction, will one day pierce their hearts and their bows will be broken. One day, the very thing which they thought would bring the end of those they despise will be the very instruments that bring about their own destruction. Better the little that the righteous have than the wealth of many wicked. Why? Why is it better for somebody to have a little than it is for all that the wicked have? Because here's the deal. Those who are defined as wicked, no relationship with God. The only heaven they'll ever know is the best that happens to them on this earth. That's it. That's all they got. And when this is gone, it's all downhill from then, folks. It may be uphill for the righteous at the moment. But one day, because of faith in Christ, it will all be downhill for us. But for the wicked, it is nothing but down after death. Little that comes from God is better than much that comes from anywhere else. Do you enjoy what you have that God has provided? Or are you always hungry for more? Verse 17, the power of the wicked, it will be broken, but the Lord upholds the righteous. The days of the blameless are known to the Lord, and their inheritance will endure forever. The wicked lose their inheritance. We gain our inheritance. In times of disaster, the righteous will not wither. In days of famine, we'll have enough. We'll enjoy plenty. But the wicked will perish, and the Lord's enemies will be like the beauty of the fields. They will vanish. How quickly? Like smoke. Poof, just like that. The wicked borrow and do not repay, but the righteous give generously. Those that the Lord bless will inherit the land, but those he curses, they will be cut off. Verse 23 is kind of a reflection back to verse 4. The Lord delights. Who does he delight in? Verse 4 said, delight ourselves in the Lord, and he will give the desires of our heart. Here's kind of the flip side. The Lord delights in the way of the man whose steps that he has made firm. The he who has made firm, the he there is the Lord, not the man. Make sure you understand that. The Lord delights in the way of the man whose steps the Lord has made firm. It's not what we think is sure footing. It's what God knows to be sure footing. The King James does the verse this way. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. That's why the Bible says that the word is a light to our path and a lamp to our feet. Though he stumble, who? Not the Lord. Though the man who's walking on firm ground, provided by the Lord, though he stumbles. Does that encourage you a wee bit? Lets us know God's very much aware. David, remember, David wrote this. David understands that, and he's writing this at a late stage in his life. David's looking back at his own life, and he said, man, since I was a boy, I had a heart for God. David looked back and said, since I was a boy, I wanted the things that God wanted for my life. There have been a few times through my life that I have stumbled on that path. But God has not let me fall. God's been there with me. That's his promise. He will never leave us, nor will he ever forsake us. So don't allow stumbles in your life. Don't allow the evil one to use that to discourage you, to keep you down. Verse 25, some of you cannot say this personally, but some of us in the room can. I was young. Those of you who can truthfully read the next part of it, say it out loud with me. I was young and now I am old, okay? That's how I know that David was later in life when he wrote this, okay? I once was young, but now I am old. Yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken or their children begging bread. Important thing to recognize here, it didn't mean that we would never have needs that we don't need to ask for. There are two occasions. One was with Abimelech that David had to go and ask for bread because he was hungry. But that was an occasion, not a lifestyle. There will be occasions in our life in which we will need to ask from others who have a bell to lead us to where we need to be. But David said this is not a lifestyle. There are choices that God, that we make about our relationship with God that will prevent that from happening. They are always generous and they lend freely. Their children will be blessed. Verse 27, turn. It's a reminder of one of those back in the first 9 verses. Turn from evil and do good. In other words, repent from your wickedness and turn to righteousness. Don't do what Sodom's wife did. This term turn here means turn, do an about face, and don't look back. When you choose a relationship with God, don't look back. Turn from evil and do good. Verse 28, for the Lord loves, and if you guys don't know the story of Lot and his wife, she turned back. She died in a twist. Okay? She became a pillar of salt. I don't have time to go into it anymore, but it's a weird story. Verse 28, for the Lord loves the just, and he will not forsake his faithful ones. They will be protected forever. But the offspring of the wicked will be cut off. The righteous will inherit the land, and they'll dwell in it forever. The mouth of the righteous man utters wisdom, and his tongue speaks what is just. I see David talking to his son, saying, son, what I'm sharing with you right now is coming to me by what God has given to me throughout my life. This is not pie in the sky. This is the reality of what I have seen and witnessed and received from God. And then this next verse, this next one sentence verse, it's so loaded. The law of his God is in his heart, and his feet do not slip. The truth of God is in his heart, and his feet do not slip. This verse tells us what the best thing is, and what the best place is, and what the best result is. The best thing is the truth of God. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Does it get better than that? The truth of God. That's the best thing. It's why Paul said, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, but one who can rightly divide the word of truth. It's one thing to read the word. It's another thing to study the word. And it's still yet another thing to know how to apply the word. Because we can study this book for the wrong reason. Have you ever gone to the Bible and studied it to prove a point? Not a good way to study it. Study the Bible to let God prove a point. That's a better way to study it. Find out what His word. That's the best thing, because these are the words of life. And the best place for the best thing is where? In our hearts. When the law of God is in our heart. You see, what you believe is the key that keeps us from falling. The best thing, the truth of God, in the best place, our hearts. What's the best result? Our feet do not slip. Our feet do not slip. The wicked lie in wait for the righteous, seeking their very lives. But the Lord will not leave them in power or let them be condemned when brought to trial. Then verse 34 is a throwback to verse 14. Wait for the Lord and keep His ways. He will exalt you to possess the land. Wait on the Lord. Walk in the Lord's ways. And the result will be He will exalt us. Wait and walk. Verse 35, I have seen a wicked and ruthless man flourishing like a green tree in native soil. Hey, in this world, the wicked may look really good. But don't be deceived by how good things look for the wicked, because soon it will pass away and there'll be no more. Though I look for them, they cannot be found. Consider the blameless. Observe the upright. For there is a future in the man of peace. But all sinners will be destroyed. The future of the wicked will be cut off. As Eve was cast out of the garden, and Adam away from the tree of life, they will be cut off from the benefits and the blessings of God's life. And verse 39 and 40, this is a summary of what grace is all about. The salvation of the righteous comes from the Lord. The righteous didn't need salvation because they were righteous. The salvation got righteousness because they were wicked. And God offered to them salvation, and they chose it. The salvation of the righteous comes from the Lord. He is their stronghold in their time of trouble. The Lord helps them and delivers them. He delivers them from wicked, and He saves them because they take refuge in Him. They put their trust in Him. This is grace condensed. Once we were wicked, but now we are righteous. This is grace epitomized. The Lord delivers us. This is grace summarized. We take refuge in them. And the entire thing is grace declared. It's available to all who are wicked. And it's the promises that are ours now because we are righteous. John Piper, in his book entitled Future Grace, reprinted a letter that was written by a man named Carl Lundquist. Carl Lundquist was the former president of Bethel Christian College and Seminary. It's been almost 30 years ago since this letter was written. It was in 1988. The doctors told Carl that he had a very rare form of cancer. It was called mycosis fungoides. I found out that was the way to say it from a doctor in the last service. This is a cancer which invades the skin of your entire body, and it usually takes its victims. Carl's life ended 3 years after the diagnosis. On the day that he heard the news about his cancer, here is the letter that he wrote. He said, that day in the hospital room, I picked up my Bible. That's what a righteous person does. When we have trouble in this world, when we hear the ravages of wickedness in this world, as it may impact our life, we do what David said would be wise to do in Psalm 37. We turn to firm soil. He said, that day in the hospital room, I picked up my Bible when the doctor left. I turned to the book of Philippians to read the verses about joy, thinking that one of them might stand out. But what ended up leaping from the pages of Philippians 1 was Paul's testimony, where Paul wrote these words, I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but I will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether it is in my life or whether it is in my death. Many of us in this room know the next verse. For me to live is Christ, but to die is better. It's gain. Boy, let that one sink in. Carl wrote, so I simply trust that God in His own way will carry out for me His will, which I know alone is good and acceptable and perfect, whether it is by my life or whether it is by my death. Jesus, be the center of my life, whether in my life or in my death. Because God, I can trust You to take care of the righteous. And because I believe in You, because I trust in You, You are my righteousness. When Jesus gets to be the center of our lives, we can agree with Carl Lundquist in his letter, who agreed with Paul in his letter, who said, for me to live, that's a good thing. For me to die is better. It's taken me a long time to try to get to this place in my own life. The dying is even better. We like to say dying's going to be okay because we're going to a good place, but no, that's not what Paul said. Paul says it's better. It's gain. As good as you may have good moments on this earth, it is not as good as where we're going. When we get there, we don't struggle near as much in fretting over the troubles in this world. Jesus, be the center of my life. I think that's what David wanted Solomon to know. Let's pray. Father, I hope we got a sense of what David was trying to say, not only to those that he wrote this song for, but what through him You wanted to say to us. Father, whether I said it exactly right or not, I trust by the activity of Your presence in our midst, You have taken your own word, and you have brought that passage, that portion, to each of our hearts that we needed, so that we really do have a firmer grasp on what it means for your Son, the Lord Jesus, to be the center of our life, that we really do want our steps to be ordered by you.